Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the L1 show. You may notice someone is missing this week. It is
Comedy Tech. He's not missing. We know where he is.
Yeah. He's not completely gone. We did think he got body snatched. She sent us some pictures of the food he was eating, and we thought he was drinking a beer.
We know where he is because we air tagged him before he left.
Multiple, actually. Just in his luggage, under his shoe. Yeah.
Popped one in his ear.
Anyway, we're doing government security today and also one design story, but it's kind of like, well, you'll see. It's kind of a design story.
And not a lot of government news this week, and maybe the autoplay video on this article indicates where all of that attention went for the entire week.
Oh, earlier it was Scarlett Johansson, so it seems like it's just, who knows?
Oh, well, now the video's changed. So yeah. My comment doesn't make sense anymore. You know what we're talking about. We won't mention it, because the algorithm probably reacts to that. But what we will mention is the FTC, which seems to have a taste for blood when it comes to these antitrust lawsuits.
FTC chair, AI models could violate antitrust laws.
Why? Well, because it's training itself on everything else. Now, learning about things in a human perspective and then talking about them or reproducing them would just be normal human behavior.
I'm wondering if that's more like because it's all one company. Like, I mean, there's multiple AI models, but ChatGPT is kind of the big one. So maybe they're like trying to get ahead of that. I'm not sure.
They're making the argument, which is valid, I suppose, that like if you're a news organization and Google is simply just gobbling up all your news and summarizing it and forcing that down people's throats, is that antitrust? Are they in your business now that they can sort of replace your business? Although, if the news companies stopped doing their business,
there'd be nothing for Google to use.
Except for other AI droppings, which seems to be...
Which is where we're headed. But I love it when I look up gardening stuff and I come across an AI-generated video because it's not even the same plant most of the time.
Yeah, there's a lot of bad information out there and the robots are not helping. So it's going to be interesting to follow. As long as it took them to come after Amazon, I wonder how long they'll build this case before they do anything.
It seems like, and maybe this is probably just how legal stuff works, but it feels like it takes forever.
It does feel like the law moves very slowly, and sometimes not at all, no matter how much people want, the will of the people really doesn't matter very often, unless you're a certain kind of person. Mm. And by that I mean a person with lots and lots of money.
Congress just made it basically impossible to track Taylor Swift's private jet. I would like to point out that I'm pretty sure she has two.
Yeah.
As well. It's not just one. It's two. And she's obviously flying them all over.
You got to lend one out, right?
That's how she, that's how her team made it sound better. They were like, oh, but she lends it out to her friends and family. I was like, is that better? Really? Yeah. Like. Oh.
So she did a world tour, so there was a lot of jet setting in Taylor's previous year. And they point out that though she is a bit of a climate change advocate and she speaks about these topics, she caused a lot of emissions with that jet. And
and it's also important to point out, like, it's not just her traveling to the venues where she goes to the venue and then flies to like New York and then back in like one night.
Well, listen,
over and over.
She's got to get back to her cats, right?
I guess, yeah.
They have health problems. That's another headline I've seen all week. So how does this work? Well, the rich with their private jets can now change up the tail numbers that are stored in the tracking system. So you can't just track one tail number because they'll change it. And the FAA knows when these changes happen, but you don't. So the dude on Twitter who's got all this tracking stuff is going to have a lot harder time keeping up with them.
Tragic. The other big Taylor Swift story this week is how she's bullying Billie Eilish. I don't know how you pronounce her last name.
What's the...
the beef there, I guess. Like, Billie made a comment about how people release, like, a ton of different various albums, like, over and over again, and how that contributes to climate change, and then Taylor Swift got mad and, like, released her albums the same day Billie released hers.
How does that contribute to climate change? It's digital now, right?
No. Taylor Swift releases actual, like, 10 different physical versions of the albums, and they all have different songs on them.
So well, that makes sense because some people are crazy enough
to do that. Yeah. I mean, she's a brilliant businesswoman.
A young Ryan in his teenage days did actively try to get all of the Nine Inch Nails halos, they called them.
Oh.
Which were just a bunch of remixes and
kind
of
that yeah. same thing. And yeah, where it's like, ooh, yeah. I have to get every version of it. That's people do that with Taylor Swift albums.
Yeah. That was a dumb move, but you know what? People do dumb things because of music. It moves us in ways that we can't really explain. Oh. I really should mute that.
I forgot to mute mine. Now we just have to sit here anxiously and waiting for mine to go off next.
Well, Amazon Prime, it's interesting every time we do a story about Amazon Prime, especially the cancellation of Amazon Prime, we usually get some comments that are like, I don't know, it was easy for me, it's real simple. And I wonder, is that astroturfing? Is that people with real experiences?
Or maybe it's just our audience is kind of used to like dealing with this kind of thing, maybe more so than the average consumer.
Well, Lina Khan is not used to it.
Amazon execs may be personally liable for tricking users into Prime signups. I'll be honest, I'm logged into Amazon most of the time when I'm browsing it, so I don't see it. But apparently they're very aggressive with their pop-ups, like, please sign up for Amazon yeah. Prime.
Same here. I've been on Prime. I'm going to stay on Prime because of the free shipping. It's totally worth it. I got a cat bed coming tomorrow that I ordered 2 hours ago. Who else is going to do that for me?
I'm torn because for in our house where we live, like it's almost never one day shipping, but when it is nice.
They accused them of having, I can't remember what, I think it was like up to 18 clicks to quit Prime.
It was so it said a 4-page form, and I think it was 15 clicks.
15 clicks.
Okay. Yeah.
But I think they have changed that maybe since then.
Possibly, but I mean, if they were still doing it. At the time, and the executives knew about it.
Now, they did point out that they got some internal communications, because remember, that's that whole, like,
yeah.
signal thing. Well, this was not a signal communication. Probably should have been. But one of the project leads was like, well, listen, maybe they will get in there by accident. But once they're in there by accident, Prime is such a good value that they're going to love it anyway. So let's not change any of this.
That's a bold strategy.
There should be a special award. Maybe if Level 1, you know, starts making millions of dollars someday, we can host an award for the engineers who get pointed out in email leaks trying to fix the problem.
Oh, yeah, like a Hall of Fame. Like, yeah.
You know how they do like the Pulitzer or the Mark Twain Prize or whatever?
Someone's fighting for the users.
We'll do the Level 1 Prize for engineers who tried to fix big tech problems in leaked emails. And someone is trying to fix the whole botnet thing, which is probably a big part of why my phone keeps ringing, because it's kind of easy to go out there and just get server space and spin up these horrible illegal activities.
Treasury sanctions creators of 911 S5 proxy botnet.
So what is 911 S5? Well, it's a service where you can go and rent space on compromised routers and computers and things like that. So they infect them. They list them up for sale, you buy access to them, and then if you want to do some scamming, you can have, it's kind of like a VPN for criminal stuff,
yeah,
basically. But the person on the other end of the VPN doesn't know that you're there. Although now they may know, because these guys weren't just doing like actual malware. They had a VPN themselves, and you could run this VPN. And they would protect you, except they would also use you as an exit node for the criminals.
It's just criminal activity all the way down.
Now they got a new version that is a little more honest.
That one looks a little more legit, too. Like, compare the website screenshots. One looks like...
Yeah, that's very... it's like 2005.
Makes me a little nervous when I see that. The other one's like, oh, maybe that's legit.
But you will still be used. This one's called Paladin VPN. But I do not think it is fighting on the side of God.
It's an oath breaker.
So watch out for free VPNs. They're always a scam. Although the paid ones might be too. Now, Krista, you were solidly on the side of no phones for kids.
Yeah.
I don't really care. I feel like if you have to raise your own kids, I'm not going to be making decisions about it. But kids are annoying with their phones. But they're annoying in general. So should they or should they not be allowed to have smartphones at all times?
New York plans to ban smartphones in schools, allowing basic phones only. This seems like a perfectly fine middle ground for the parents who are like, I might need to get hold of my kid during the day, but also not being a huge distraction in classrooms.
How fast is somebody going to make a little flip phone with smartphone capabilities, but like stealth?
That's a huge like gap in the market, right? If I was a smartphone maker.
But as a kid, could you convince your parents that you need that one? Probably, right? Because they're not going to look that far into it.
Yeah, it's like, oh, everyone at school has this one.
Yeah. Also, I love how the one kid in the back is actually reading the book.
Yeah, everyone else is just looking at their phones. Maybe they're looking at e-readers. You don't know. They're definitely not looking at TikTok.
This is great. This is nice to see. It's kind of like bowling pins slowly falling down. We shouldn't have to do this, but we do, and it's good to see.
Another U.S. state repeals law that protected ISPs from municipal competition.
Minnesota.
Woo!
So these are old laws that were in place for the phone industry. So it's like, listen, you can't just blow into town and create some fly-by-night phone company. We're not going to let that happen. You know, there's infrastructure and everything. And the ISPs, who were previously phone companies in a lot of situations, they just sort of carried all that over to the ISP world and took advantage of it. And oh boy, as we covered last week, do they fight bitterly against these things. But it's not working, which is great. It's great to see when propaganda fails.
Well, is anything more rage-inducing than slow internet?
Yeah.
I can deal with no internet, but slow internet is way worse.
Or just refusal to bring internet to your home.
Yeah.
Because you're not profitable enough.
And then it's like, oh, now I can't find a house to live in. Because I have to have internet for my job.
And the war on AI is continuing. And of course, you know, much like the whole protect the children thing, it's all about the deepfakes. That's how they're going to scare you.
California advances measures targeting AI discrimination and deepfakes.
Now, the AI discrimination thing is actually probably for the best, because that, according to this article, will include the whole hell of trying to apply for jobs and getting screened at every level.
Not by human, but just, right. Yeah.
But I wonder how a regulator could ever prove, like, they'll just lie about it, don't you think?
Well, a lot of those AI screener things are like software solutions. So maybe it's like, if we see your company bought one of these, or
hide that.
Yeah.
But they will also have some restrictions in here for companies that are creating generative AI. I'm a little more worried about that because that becomes just like government gets to decide what AI can and can't do for the blebs. But we'll see. It's definitely getting a little out of hand and it's moving fast.
I'm so old and tired. I can't keep up with it.
Another thing that is moving not as fast as it used to, but we did have a kind of a spurt there of electric vehicle adoption, certainly in California. I think they were the state with the most, right? Because they're hip. They love that kind of stuff. But there is a big problem with that.
California launching pilot program to charge drivers for miles driven. Could replace the gasoline tax that we have currently.
Because EV drivers don't pay gasoline tax. And it turns out there's a massive shortfall in road taxes because of all the EVs. Now, of course, you don't have to think too hard about how this is going to be bad, because the biggest question is, how do I know how much you drove?
Oh, we just have that built right into cars from 2025 onward. Yeah.
And right now, only the car company and the insurance companies and whoever they sell it to has access. But something tells me that Gavin Newsom...
The government can just buy it, right? Because that's totally legal.
That is true. Yeah, I guess we're not going to stop them.
They don't even need to do anything special there. It's just buy it.
Now, they did cover that. They said that you could, of course, install an app on your new car.
No,
everybody wants that. Or you could, in the worst possible case, take a picture of it, which I could see people easily circumventing.
That's trivial. What would?
I mean, just keep taking pictures every day and choose how much you wanted to drive that month.
Yeah.
And then send that in. I just don't drive anymore. I don't know. They wouldn't believe mine because I drive so little.
Yeah, it's like, well, time for my weekly town trip.
And Colorado should be celebrated because they've been at the forefront of this. And we already knew about this. There's not a lot of new details, but today's the day, or not today, but it was May 28th was the day when it finally happened.
Governor Polis signs bill mandating that consumers have more options to fix electronics.
He specifically mentioned the hardware pairing.
Right.
That whole thing. There was one line in here that worried me, which was that Google had worked tirelessly with the lawmakers here to draft parts of the law, which
you mean probably the Google help. That shelves projects left, right, and center?
And is decidedly not into this kind of thing.
Yeah.
Although if it hurts Apple...
I'll cut off my nose despite my face if it means hurting Apple.
Yeah. Google worked alongside Democratic leaders in the best interest of consumers. I'm going to say that in the last decade, Google has never done anything in the best interest of consumers.
I'm trying to think.
Unless it, again, was just to spite Apple. They might have done... I guess they did the whole, like, the manifest and the cookie tracking stuff. But that was purely a business play. That wasn't really for privacy. And also, it's never really happened.
I like Google Fonts, all right. But I'm sure one day that'll be put in the graveyard, too.
But isn't that a big part of their... tracking?
I mean,
if you're hitting their CDN, then
they could probably use that. Yeah,
let's build an ad profiles somewhere
somehow.
And as you know, the European Union has the big Digital Markets Act, and the UK is not in the European Union anymore, so it's not covered by that. But they have one that's eerily similar, but that's not for, you know, they're not copying it.
That's totally different.
They just came up, it's just parallel thinking is what's happening here.
UK law will let regulators fine big tech without court approval.
Sounds a little terrifying.
We got to get those funds as fast as possible and court slows it down.
That worried me a bit because anytime it's like unelected bureaucrats just grabbing money, like, I don't know, but they do have a nice carve out. And I think the DMA has it as well, where it's only for these major companies that they designate. You have to have like 100 million in global sales or something like that, which that helps. Hopefully, there might be loopholes, but hopefully that keeps the big companies from using that as like regulatory capture
and
eliminating competition. And over in the UK, they've had a couple of scandals. One we'll talk about in the nonsense section. But there's also this one. And this is, I mean, when you make this admission, shouldn't this be part of your resignation letter? Because what's your purpose after this?
Environment agency chief admits regulator buries freedom of information requests.
Why would they do that? Because he says it's quote unquote embarrassing. The reality is so embarrassing that it seems like the agency might be doing nothing. So they just work around the FOIA requests.
That is just...
And they are willing to admit it.
Listen, we're really bad at our jobs, and I'd rather you didn't audit what I'm doing.
I mean, you can audit it, but it's going to take 6-7 years. I mean, look at the backlog. We got one guy working on this. He's blind.
He's on vacation half the time. Oh, this is such a tiny headline. I don't know if I'll be able to read it. Here, let's go.
This is, this is the topic that is close to your heart. Now, New York is saying basic phones only. And this one sounds like it's saying none at all.
UK MP's Full Metal Panic.
Full Metal Panic.
What does it say?
That's the episode title. Full Metal Panic.
I can't read it from this distance.
Moral Panic.
That's too scary. It's too far away. Tech Nerd's headlines are too small.
Okay. Decide to ignore the research. Push for danger span on phones for kids. So they're saying under 16 years of age... No phones for children at all.
Wow. Not even at home. That's interesting. Do they have access to like PCs or tablets or other educational digital material?
I think it's maybe just phones. I mean, you couldn't stop them from using computers, right? That's way too far. I mean, this is too far. The government shouldn't be making this decision, but it's interesting. Now, they point out, there's a lot of industry groups and NGOs that get quoted in here. And it's very difficult for me to determine, like, is there a lot of corporate influence happening here? Because they don't want those sales to go away.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it does kind of feel like phones maybe are bad for kids, But all of this research is saying it's not. They also say that social media is not bad for kids.
I don't know if I believe that.
I think social media might be bad for everybody.
Yeah, I don't think social media is great. I think nothing's necessarily bad in moderation. The issue is, like, none of these companies want you to be moderate. They want you to be on their thing all the time, constantly consuming their stuff, and then they're collecting your data.
They also have some pretty solid stats here about the decline in our children and the incline of various mental disorders that we're diagnosing in our children. But the argument against that they have here is that was all just COVID, and that's over, and we're going to be okay.
I mean, probably didn't help, but, like, maybe two things could be true at once. I don't know.
Even though as we inch closer to the election, that bird flu drum keeps getting beat pretty hard. And Canada, we've lost Canada. I don't know what's happening up there, but it's nothing good. And this, now, you know, I do have to say that as an American, they're doing this here. But they're not this brazen about it. They hide it. They're ashamed of it.
Ottawa wants the power to create secret backdoors in our networks to allow for surveillance. Our big brother down south gets to do that. Why can't we?
And they're doing it to us anyway. Yeah, so they're saying they want to be able to order any telecommunication company to install a backdoor to track. I think it's per case. So this is kind of like, you know, one target at a time. But again, if we look at how our deep state is doing this, it starts that way. And then they're like, oh yeah, here's the number of Americans we accidentally caught in the FISA. We're going to do it again.
Also, yes, you misunderstand too. It's only a backdoor for us. No one else could potentially take advantage of that. Only we could get in.
That is what they point out, obviously, that if this is recorded, it's going to be leaked. Because no one can secure data in the modern day. And, yeah, it's going to be bad. Over in Russia, the sanctions continue to bite. And much like China, their solution is we got to just start doing everything ourselves, right? Every country has to have their own version of everything from now on.
Russia mulling charging companies to use foreign software.
Because, I mean, you know, if you're a Russian company, you don't really have a lot of options in terms of homegrown software that's going to replace the Western stuff, right?
Yeah.
At least not yet. So how do you force people to switch? You charge them money, I guess. They didn't have a lot of details. They didn't really lay anything out. Also, Putin made some really vague, weird comments about everybody needs to mobilize, as in, like, total war is coming. But he didn't say exactly what was going on there.
They kind of do that a lot. It's really hard to know what to take seriously because it seems like we get threats like that every week now.
Yeah, we live in an age of constant threats, that's for sure. And speaking of China and doing that exact thing, that is what they are continuing to do.
China sets up third fund with $47.5 billion to boost semiconductor sector. It's a lot of money.
It's a lot of money.
Yeah.
It's okay, though, because they can print all the money they want.
They're not around Taiwan right now, which is good for this week, next 2 weeks.
You know where they are is in Hong Kong, and they have completely taken over, and they have rewritten the laws, and they've replaced all of the judiciary, and now we get the inevitable.
Hong Kong makes first arrests under new domestic security law.
What was the crime? Social media post.
Yeah.
Social media post, and that was just one woman. But the other, was it five or, yeah, five other people were just helping her. Like, they were supporting the social
just
media.
Just hit, like, the like button or whatever.
Well, I think they're trying
to. I misclicked.
I think they're trying to say that they were, like, part of crafting it. You know, like her support network. And, well, that's terrifying. I mean, yeah. I'm not saying that we don't have something akin to that here, but we're not quite to this level
no.
yet. And this, of course, one of the big things, one of the interesting things about Wendell being in Taiwan right now is the Tiananmen Square anniversary is coming up. And that was what was whatever posted about on their
social
media.
Like it's too close to whatever date, and it's like, oh, I thought we don't talk about that.
Yeah. And of course, and we talk about Canada's not going to be able to save your data. No one can keep your data safe. And that is just so obvious every week because we see giant companies unable to do so.
Cooler Master's customer data leaked in data breach.
Did you buy anything from the Cooler Master website directly? Did you fill out a warranty card? Did you have customer support? Well, if so, it's been lost.
Bad news, everybody.
But that one is pretty small in comparison to this one.
Hackers claim Ticketmaster data.
Ticketmaster would be such a better name.
It would be. 560 million users info for sale at 500K. Whew.
That's a lot of people. Seems like Ticketmaster keeps your information forever. And it's not just your contact information, but all of the venues that you've been to. Ooh. All of the concerts, now your entire history.
They look at it and they're like, ugh, this person likes these artists. They're not even worth talking to.
So here it is. Someone has posted on one of these breach forums. They have some samples that you can go and confirm. Looks like it's real. Unfortunate.
Everyone's going to know I went to a Taylor Swift show.
They're going to know that you went to a Taylor Swift show one weekend and a rodeo the next one.
Oh.
Who does that?
Does Ticketmaster do rodeo? I guess they do. They do everything.
They own everything.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
There's a rodeo here that comes every year, but I don't think that's involved with Ticketmaster at all.
No. Yeah, that's our little fairgrounds. Yeah. Probably not Live Nation properties. I don't think it might be, though. And usually it's just us plebs who get hacked and horribly taken advantage of. But this week, we had one that affects the one percenters.
Ransomware group claims responsibility for Christie's hack.
That is the auction house that is famous for auctioning off art, very expensive items, things like that. And they were keeping everybody's information as well. But clearly a much more powerful group of people lost data here. Be interesting.
I'll say that's probably, people are going to care about that one more than.
Yeah. They also shut down their ability to do online bidding this year. They had to scramble and try to get a new because this happened right before one of their big spring auctions. So, interesting. And this, we've seen this headline sort of like recycled over and over and over. Healthcare, everything. But it all comes down to the tracking pixels. And every website has them, including the ones that you have to use and that you have to give information to that you really don't want to be out there.
Google accused of secretly tracking drivers with disabilities.
So if you want to go and renew your stuff for your, I guess, like handicap parking or whatever.
Your sticker.
It's got a Google tracking pixel on it. So Google knows that you submitted stuff to that form. And they've got, they're tracking your account. They know your IP. So now they can make a pretty good guess on your ad profile, which we'll learn more about later, that you might be disabled. You're a disabled driver.
You start getting ads for that.
Like, yeah, related, for sure. Yeah. Right? Like you got those vans with like the lift.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That kind
crutches,
of stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. Disgusting. And it could be fixed in 10 minutes per website, probably. Just remove it.
No, we need that.
And the scam calls, it never stops. These days, it's just robots. Like, they don't even have to use the Indians anymore. You think there's an apocalypse in the Indian call center like there is in the tech jobs in America?
Probably to some extent,
we
yeah.
don't need them anymore. But when you get those calls, what's the best way to trick you? Who would you trust the most if I'm lying to you and telling you that's who I am?
Best Buy and Geek Squad were most impersonated orgs by scammers in 2023.
But Microsoft. Microsoft was the one that people believed for whatever reason. If you call them up and you're like, I'm Mr. Microsoft.
I'm Mr. Microsoft. This is Bill Gates himself.
People buy it.
That's insane.
And so even though 72% were Geek Squad and Best Buy and the other top two, which was Amazon and PayPal, they did not have the line. Even together, they did not have more actual money than Microsoft.
Wow.
I guess people are like, you know, they're using a Windows computer and they understand that and they know that's Microsoft. And they're like, well, of course they would call me.
Yeah, that makes more sense than, yeah, I guess not a lot of people go to, I don't know. Some people go to Best Buy. I don't know who, but.
Wouldn't they lay off all the Geek Squad?
I thought so too. I didn't know if Geek Squad was still a thing, but.
We know what might not be a thing is the Internet Archive, which is terrible because this is one of the last ways that we can actually, in the world of memory holes, at least you can go back and see what they changed.
Internet Archive and the Wayback Machine under DDoS cyber attack. That is tragic because I love the Wayback Machine.
They don't know who's doing it, but they do point out that they are under constant attack from basically these, you know, groups that don't want
to have you have a record. Yeah.
And it's not necessarily, you know, like the cybercrime groups. It's industry type groups and stuff like that. So they also, a lot of these groups fight them on the grounds of like, you know, libraries should be done away with because books are worth money and we want to sell them. Or the same for websites. And certainly now that you can sell data to the AI companies.
Yeah. Well, we sourced this other website in our article and people could just go to that one.
You know, it's interesting if they pass those laws that says you can't just go out and scrape everything if you're a big company, would that stop them?
Oh, that's a good point.
Because it's kind of what they're doing, but they're doing it for less nefarious reason.
They also, yeah, they let anybody access it.
OpenAI should just secretly buy them.
Oh, don't say, don't put those thoughts into the world. Don't you know they'll hear?
Well, I was without internet for a day.
Same.
Actually, no, the power was out the day before, so technically I was out for 2 days. And it's awful.
On a holiday weekend, no less.
And I hate it, and I feel really bad for these people because they've been out for a lot longer.
Mystery malware destroys 600,000 routers from a single ISP during a 72-hour span.
This is Windstream, which is one of the wireless internet providers who stuff my mailbox every week. They will not stop.
But free trash.
No one knows exactly. They know what malware they use because they've gotten one and sort of, you know, deconstructed it. But it was a commercial malware with no fingerprints. Chalubo?
Gesundheit.
And they know how it worked, but they're not sure why or what the game was here.
For the lulz.
I guess, but these people are screwed and there's really no fix for this. And you can see here, like, there was lots of them, and then there weren't.
God, that sucks. Oh, I'd be salty.
And the whole intellectual property theft and stuff like that is going strong. And China, more than ever, needs it because they've been sanctioned out of a lot of the market.
Former South Korean Hynix employee charged with stealing tech for Huawei. Chinese national was arrested at airport.
Now, these companies know this kind of thing is going on.
Yeah.
And they safeguard against it. And they, you cannot get a USB drive into one of these places. They must, like, pat you down. They might have those, like, electronic sniffing dogs or whatever. So she printed out 2,400 pages, I think.
It's not even subtle.
And she's been there since 2013. So she took a long time. But even then, they have safeguards, and the system flagged, and it was like, this person's printing way too much.
Nobody prints anymore. What year is it?
So they went back and looked at what she printed, and they're like, oh, yeah.
Wow.
This is being exfiltrated to China. And the next time she flew back from China, they picked her up at the airport.
That was really thoughtful of them. She was going to have to take a cab otherwise.
And the only design story this week has turned out to be a bit of a popcorn fart.
Yeah.
Because The Verge gave us a design story, zero screenshots.
Discord's turning the focus back to games. I think this is more of a, like, a strategy, less so than a design thing. Because, like, they mentioned in the article, a lot of Discord, they've been trying to compete a little bit with, like, more corporate software, like Teams, and Zoom. Certainly. And they're like, we don't maybe need to be in that market right now.
Yeah. Well, that market, you know, blew up there for a couple of years and then really pulled back, so I think they're just reacting to the times. But
getting rid of some features.
Probably
I think.
Discord, like, I start it 2 times a week, maybe 3. I go right to our little voice channel. I never look at anything else. But it's constantly popping up as like, oh, you want Nitro? Oh, you should go here.
Oh, yeah, they have the Nitro thing now. I hate that.
You should click this. They have a store. We got a new feature. And it's like, no. I just want to talk to people for a very limited amount of time.
That's what it's good for. Like, I mean, it's got that stupid store that they advertise all the time. But, like, you can just kind of have your server, talk to your people, and, like, that's all it does. That's all it needs to do.
They got that Whisper, I think is the name of it, that noise cancellation. It won't let anybody hear my cats.
No, unless they're really loud. Sometimes they come through.
Sometimes cricket, but it's only when you talk. Like, if you're talking and cricket's in the background,
screaming, yeah.
Yeah.
Sometimes we hear yours, too, but they have to be close to the mic, I think.
They need to adapt that so it's pet friendly. People want to hear from the cats.
They've got important thoughts on meetings and gaming sessions.
All right, we squeezed 35 minutes out of that, which was more than it deserved.
Not bad. Anyway, we will see you guys in the next one.